A portion of today's video is sponsored by Car Gurus.
Hey you.
Yeah you. Do you want a cheap, powerful, and reliable engine that can pretty much do it all? One that rips but doesn't rip into your old pocketbook? No, I'm not talking about GM's LS1. I'm talking about Nissan's LS1, a V6 with an iconic growl, the VQ engine. Today, we're gonna talk about what makes this engine so balanced, so smooth, so ubiquitous. And we're gonna do that by focusing on how the engineers cut vibration, bolstered rigidity, and sent all that smooth power into a smooth close ratio transmission. We about to get freaking smooth in here. Thanks to Car Gurus for sponsoring this portion of today's video. Now, are you looking for a car, but might be a little nervous that you're not getting the best deal? Well, with Car Gurus, they give every car a deal rating. That way, you'll know if you're getting the best price. I bought a truck last summer and I overpaid like an idiot, and it still keeps me up at night. So don't burden yourself with having the constant reminder that you got screwed. Don't be me. You see, Car Gurus is selective. Only 1 out of 5 cars getting their good deal rating. So when they say it's a good deal, it actually is one. Car Gurus also gives you the complete vehicle history and other unique info, like how long the car has been sitting on the lot. That way, you can negotiate an even better price when you get to the dealership. Car Gurus knows that for some people, purchasing a car just can't wait. So they have partnered with dealerships across the country to provide contactless shopping options so you can safely find, test drive, and purchase a car during the COVID-19 outbreak. Click the link in the description to go find your next car today or visit cargurus.com. And thanks to Car Gurus for sponsoring this portion of the video. Just like the Chevy LS1, the Nissan VQ is a cheap, reliable way to make a bunch of power. This engine is also extremely versatile, which is why it's found in a bunch of different Nissan models. It's one of the reasons we bought 2 identical 350Zs a while ago. And you know what you guys should do? Hit that bell and notification, because we got Hi-Low Season 2 coming out this week. So you wanna know when that drops? Hit the little bell. Hit the subscribe, that helps us out. You can tune them, you can hoon them, and you can boon them, boy. Now there are various VQ models, but we're gonna focus on one in particular, the VQ35HR, or high rev, cause it's the creme de la creme of VQs. Now this updated version of the VQ35DE is almost completely redesigned, with 80% of the internals being strengthened and reconfigured to handle a higher rev range. Now other iconic engines like the 2JZ or their RB26 might be able to handle more power and more compression, but the VQ35HR, it holds a little baby secret. Come here. It's lighter than all of them. Now all that is thanks to an aluminum block and head. Now compared to its inline iron block cousins, the RB and the 2J, the 60 degree V6 saves weight and space because it's shorter than an inline six. Because it has a smaller geometry, it can be squeezed into a smaller engine bay, saving space, which then saves weight. That's good. But it's not just weight, or lack of weight, I should say, that makes this engine great. It's the versatility as well. The VQ is able to make a bunch of torque, around 260 pound-feet of it, which is why they put this engine in SUVs as well. The VQ35HR can be found in the Infiniti FX35 and the EX35. And stock versions can be anywhere from 297 to 360 horsepower when it's paired with an electric motor, like in the hybrid Infiniti M35H. The H means horse hybrid. You didn't know that. And if you didn't put it together from the engine code, this thing revs high, all the way up to 7,600 RPM. But you might be saying, okay, revs that high, but Jer, you can get much more power from a 2J. You can get much more torque from an LS. You can get much more tension from an RB. And all that is true, but that's not what makes the VQ an all-time great engine. Okay, sure, the ability to tune this engine is a great feature, but it's something else that makes the VQ35HR truly great. So to understand why this engine is so good, we have to look at all the forces it's able to handle and how the engineers balance those forces. Now V12s, inline sixes, V6s, inline fours, they all have different forces acting during their combustion cycle, which creates some engines being inherently more balanced than others. But what does that even mean? What does having a balanced engine mean? Well, there's two types of balance. There's primary and there's secondary. And primary engine balance has to do with the force exerted from the pistons going up and down in the cylinder. And perfect primary balance is the end goal for any engine manufacturer. That's what you want, it's the holy grail. And an engine is balanced in different ways, one of them being with reciprocating mass. If all the pistons went up and down together, that engine wouldn't be balanced at all, and there would be a ton of vibration. The engine would probably shake itself apart. You know, like that. So those forces need to be balanced in order to cut down on vibration and make power delivery more uniform. And when the piston is going up, another piston is going down. And one piston is at top dead center, and the reciprocating piston is at bottom dead center. Well, that's the top of the cylinder, that's at the bottom of the cylinder. Now, if you look at it on a graph with the y-axis being piston position and the x-axis being time, the movement of the piston makes a sinusoidal curve. And that's just a fancy word that I can barely say that describes the way a shape makes. It's like this, it's like a snake. Just think of a snake. So you see how that second piston is opposite of that first piston? This counterbalance is crucial, but it's also not the only thing keeping these forces in line. Now, another way to fight these forces is with counterweights. And counterweights are weighted pieces that sit at the base of the piston at the connecting rod, and they counteract the force of the piston going up and down in the cylinder in the same reciprocating way that the pistons do. And by adding these weights, they can help further alleviate engine vibration. But they also introduce a bit of lateral force to the engine, which can be detrimental. Any energy that's not going directly into the crank is lost energy. So even if the pistons are exerting equal forces against each other, there still might be unbalanced forces afoot. And that's where secondary engine balance comes into play. Now, secondary engine balance is a little more complicated, and in basic terms, it's caused by the piston traveling faster towards the top of the cylinder than it does towards the bottom of the cylinder. Now, that might be a little confusing, but we're gonna figure it out. Watch. So to understand this, we're going to have a look at the different phases of one rotation of the crankshaft. Now let's assume bottom dead center is at 0 degrees and top dead center is at 108 degrees. So you have 90 degrees and 270 degrees in between them. Now when the piston is traveling between the 90 degree position and the 270 degree position, the distance it has to travel is further than the distance it travels when the piston is moving from 270 degrees to zero and then back to 90 degrees again. Now because this distance is further, the piston has to move faster in the same amount of time. And that's because the shape of the crank isn't perfectly symmetrical. Does that make sense? Great, if it does, you're now a certified B2B engineer. We should actually have a school. We should have the Donut Institution. B2B can be like your engineering course. Money Pit, that's like shop class. Up to Speed, that's history. Yeah, Wheelhouse is like biology. You're always learning stuff. It's right there in front of your face, but you never really knew about it. And that's what Nolan does with cars. He has the ability to tell you all this stuff that's right there in your face that you didn't know. And then when you do know, you're like, cool. Love my biology teachers. Now this slight difference in distance results in a slight arrhythmia, which causes more vibration. Now since it's happening twice per rotation of the crank, it's double the frequency of the fundamental frequency of the engine. Now the more harmonious the engine is, the smoother it will run and vibrations will be minimized. Now inline sixes are some of the most inherently balanced engines. It's V6 bro, they need a little bit of help. It's kind of like Tony Stark and his Iron Man suit, okay? He needs a little bit of engineering help to be the master that he is. So what little bits of engineering help do V6s need? Well, stay with me, we're gonna talk about it. When I say inherently balanced, what does that mean? Well, it means that it almost has perfect primary and secondary balances. It doesn't need some of that Tony Stark engineering to help with its balance. And that's because there are three sets of reciprocating masses. That's the pistons, there's three sets of two. And if you look at the firing order of an inline six, the pistons are exactly mirrored. The pistons on the end, pistons one and six, they fire at the same time. Same with pistons two and five, and same with pistons three and four. Well, that's great for inline engines, Jerry Berry, but we're talking about V-shaped engines here. So what's the deal? Why are they slightly less balanced? Well, in the firing order, the pistons of a V6 are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Pretty simple to remember. Additionally, the cylinder banks are at a different angle than an inline, so the pistons shoot in different directions instead of just up and down. So the HR needs some additional components. It needs some Tony Stark engineering to counteract those unbalanced forces. Now, a lot of that is taken care of with a harmonic balancer, or damper as some people call it. Now, the power that is sent to the crankshaft from the pistons can cause something called torsional vibration, which is when the crankshaft shifts around in its housing. So the harmonic balancer is connected to the free end of the crank and it absorbs some of those torsional vibrations. Since the crankshaft and inline engines are longer than their V-shaped counterparts, torsional vibration is a bigger concern with those engines because they have much more of an opportunity to flex and contort.
Think about it, you got a longer bar. You can twist a little bit easier. When it's short, it's really hard to do that.
Now, in order to make the new VQ more rigid and less prone to vibration, Nissan engineers devised a ladder frame called a main cap girdle to the bottom of their engine. It's a girdle. It's just like how grandmas wear a girdle so they remain rigid when they're standing up. You know what a girdle is. Go into your mom's closet. She's gonna be like, what are you doing here? I'm like, I'm learning science, mom. If that grandma line doesn't work for you, just go ask your mom what a girdle is. And she's gonna say, zip it, Chad. Just eat your corn pops, okay? Best case scenario, your mom whips out a girdle. Now, either way, this new girdle helped to stiffen up the engine quite a bit. And not only that, it prevents crank walk. And crank walk is when the crankshaft shifts too much in the crankcase. Now, this girdle also prevents other parts of the engine from twisting and moving and deforming, which is pretty typical in a high power, high torque engine. But the block isn't the only thing that needed to be beefed up. Now, with a high powered engine, all those little bips and bops and boops and stuff are under a lot of stress. And the internal components in the VQDE wouldn't have been able to handle that stress without being bolstered. So the connecting rods on the piston in the DE are 8 millimeters thick and 9 millimeters thick in the HR. Now 1 millimeter might not be that much. That's 12.5% thicker. Think about if you were 12.5% thicker. And although it's only 1 millimeter difference, the connecting rods in the HR are 25% stronger. And the main caps, those are the pieces that hold the crankshaft in place. Now they have 4 bolts instead of the normal 2, which provides a sturdier structure in which the crankshaft sits and adds to the overall rigidity of the engine. You're just having more and more ways to make this engine more rigid and prevent a bunch of vibrations. Now the reduced vibrations and the increased rigidity in the VQ allow for a smooth power delivery, but that's only part of the equation. And this is where we're gonna talk about the transmission. And yeah, I know, okay, it's technically not a VQ engine. The transmission is different than the engine, but the right transmission can dictate how your car performs. And it's a great transmission, and we wanna talk about it, so we're gonna do it. So in this section, we're gonna focus on one of the transmissions from the 350Z, specifically the JK41B 6-speed manual transmission. Now this gearbox is smooth for a number of reasons. One of them being that it utilizes close ratio gears. Now somehow, we've never explained close ratio gears here on B2B, so this is gonna be fun. We're all gonna learn, it's great. Now in the most basic terms, a close ratio transmission has gears that are close in ratios. It's the same thing as having a 10-speed bike and a 20-speed bike. Say you're riding a 10-speed bike and you pedal, pedal, pedal. The workload puts on your legs becomes less and less, right? And when it comes time to shift to a higher gear, there's a bit of a jolt when your legs get used to having to do the extra work of this new gear. Legs are like, hey, what the heck? Why are you shifting gears on me? And you're like, shut up, legs, I'm trying to go faster. They were just moving so fast, and now they have to adjust. They're like, oh, this is harder to do, I can't go as fast. But in a 20-speed bike, like say Felipe's got a 20-speed bike, you're shifting twice as much, and that makes the ride a lot smoother. It's not such a jolt to your legs as with a 10-speed bike, because there are gears that are closer together in ratio. And the same principle can be applied to the transmission found in the Z. Now, close ratio gearing wouldn't be smooth without the unique synchronizers that Nissan employs in their 6-speed transmission. You don't know what a synchro is? Don't worry, you're in good hands. You're in my hands. Now, the synchronizer synchronizes the speed of the input and the output shafts in the transmission. In this case, the crankshaft and the driveshaft, and it aligns the gears while you're shifting.
It makes the whole process of shifting and engaging gears a lot smoother and quicker. And if you didn't have a synchro, the gears would grind against each other. Fun little fact, we did an episode on Peterbilt a couple weeks back, and they use transmissions that don't have synchronizers. So if you ever wondered, like, hey, why does that big rig sound like it's grinding gears? Well, it's because the drivers have to manually synchronize the engine RPM so that it can shift from one gear to the next. Now, synchros are shared by adjacent gears. For instance, first gear and second gear, they share a synchro, and the same with gears 3, 4, 5, and 6. And that's because they live between those gears. Now, reverse gear doesn't need a synchro because the car needs to be at a dead stop for it to engage. And that's because the input shaft and the output shaft are already synchronized because they're not moving. But what sets smooth transmissions apart from really smooth transmissions is the amount of friction rings per synchro. Now, in the case of the JK41B transmission, the first, second, and third gears all have triple cone synchros, and fourth gear has a double cone. And I know that's a lot, but stick with me. Now, if you have one friction ring taking on all that friction and slowing down the shafts, it's going to be rougher and slower than having multiple rings doing the same job. But with multiple rings doing the same job, they're working together to handle that acceleration much quicker and smoother, which makes it easier on the driver. And all that helps to make the driving experience that much better when you're in one of these cars. The engineers of this engine, of this transmission, when they put it in the 350Z, they did a great job. And you know what we did? We bought two 350Zs and we tried to engineer them better. We recorded the whole series. It's called High Low. And actually, season two is dropping this week. So go back, watch season one. If you didn't, we took two cars that were the same. We put expensive parts on one. We put cheaper parts on the other. We pitted them against themselves. That fireworks still going off. I don't know if you can hear it, but it's fireworks season in LA. F***ing hell. Thanks so much, guys, for watching. Follow me on Instagram at Jeremiah Burton. Got a cool car you want to see on the show or cool bit of engineering? Hit me up. Let me know what you want to see. Follow us on Donut at Donut Media. Bye for now.